Hello children, welcome back to our next session in biology. Hope all of you are safe and good. How are you all? It's a long time since we have met. We really miss you all, but then considering the existing situation, we have to take on or we have to continue with our classes as we are doing now. So please cooperate and listen to the classes. Now children, it's the last topic in our curriculum of 9th standard is improvement in food resources. What is this chapter about? In this chapter, we'll be studying about the improvement in agriculture and improvement in animal husbandry. Now, why are we discussing about these two concepts? Children, you know that man's basic necessity is food, apart from clothes and shelter. And India is basically an agricultural country. Our population is increasing. So in order to feed the increasing mouths, we need a proper system in agriculture and animal husbandry. So in this chapter, we'll be learning about these two very important sciences, that is a science of agriculture and about animal husbandry. What are the measures that we can take in order to increase our production in both food as well as milk? Because these two are the basic necessities of a human being in order to survive. So let us continue with the chapter. Now, coming back to the chapter, you know that our population is more than 1 billion and it is growing. It is still continuing. It's continuing to grow. There is no stop for that. So that many mouths to feed. Just imagine when so many people are there, naturally their food and their shelter or their safety has to be considered. So what can be done? We can increase our production. But then that is also very much limited. Don't you think so? Because if the population is increasing, naturally we have to provide shelter for them. They need houses to live in. So for that, they need land. So we cannot use more than a certain amount of land for agriculture. Already we are having agricultural lands, but then we cannot take up more agricultural lands because we need some lands for the housing purposes also. Then what can we do? Yes, we can increase the quantity of production in the existing land. So the production efficiency of the crops and the livestock can be increased by adopting certain scientific processes or scientific practices to improve the crop yield. This can be done in an extremely scientific manner. There are various methods like mixed cropping can be done, intercropping can be done, some modern practices, integrated farming practices like combining agriculture with animal husbandry. These are the various practices that our government is taking up, or more initiatives are being taken up in this particular field, because we cannot increase the area of the land. Already we are extensively cultivating our lands. We are having maximum lands under cultivation. Now we cannot take up more lands. Otherwise housing of the people will be a problem. So whatever lands we are having in hand now, in those lands, how to increase the production? The production efficiency of the crops and the livestock can be increased by adopting certain scientific practices, scientific management practices. Why scientific management practices are required? Then only the production can be increased, the yield can be increased, mixed farming can be done, more scientific methods like intercropping, crop rotation, etc. can be implemented. Apart from that, we can also take up another proper occupation along with agriculture, that is animal husbandry. Animal husbandry involves certain farming practices like livestock keeping, poultry keeping, fisheries, beekeeping, etc. You will find that every farmer in India will have some animals in his farm. So naturally, when he keeps up those farms also, when he maintains those farms in a proper scientific manner, definitely his income is increased. So agriculture and animal husbandry are complementary occupations, one helping the another. So in this chapter, we'll be studying about agriculture and animal husbandry in detail. Now we go over to different types of crops. Agriculture definitely involves the growing of crops. There are various types of crops around you. You know that we are depending on cereals like rice, wheat, bajra, millets, etc., which give us carbohydrates. Pulses are there as a daily component of our food, like peas are there, beans, gram, lentils, which provide us proteins. Oil seeds like groundnut seeds, sesame, castor, mustard, linseed, etc., which provide us with fats. Vegetables, spices, fruits, etc., give us vitamins and minerals along with carbohydrate, fats, and proteins. Then apart from that, fodder crops. You know what are fodder crops? The crops that are exclusively grown to provide the food for the livestock. That means for the animals in the field, like barseem, oats, Sudan grass are the examples of fodder crops. So in this way, we come to learn about different crops, and each of these crops require different climatic conditions. You know that they require different type of soil, climate, temperature, rainfall, etc. Even sunlight is different for different crops. The availability of sunlight for different crops are different, and that period during which sunlight is available to a particular crop is called the photoperiod. The photo period is also different for different crops. So anyway, in India, we are having two basic type of crops. They are the Kharif crops and the Rabi crops. Kharif crops are the crops that are grown mainly during the rainy season. You have learned about them in 8th standard also. That is the period between June and October. The examples of Kharif crops are paddy, soya bean, maize, pigeon pea, green gram. You may just learn three or four names. And the Rabi crops are the crops grown during the winter season. That is, to be very specific, November to April. Examples are wheat, gram, peas, mustard, linseed, etc. are the timings, are the crops. Now, when we talk about agriculture, I told you that already we are using many, many lands. We are using lot of land. But then, so what can we do? We have to increase the yield in those lands. How can we done? How can it be done? It can be improved by three main activities. They are the crop variety improvement, crop production improvement, and crop protection management. What do you mean by crop variety improvement? Now, when we discuss about crop variety improvement, what do you mean by that? It means that you are increasing the yield of the crops. How can it be done? By using a scientific method called hybridization. What is hybridization? Hybridization means the cross between genetically dissimilar plants to obtain crops having some desired characters like disease resistance, good quality, high yield, faster maturation, etc. So that is called hybridization. Actually, you are crossing two different plants which are genetically dissimilar. Why are you taking those two plants? Because you like certain qualities in a particular plant. Maybe you like a plant because it is more resistant to diseases. Maybe you like another plant because it matures very fast. Maybe you like that plant because its quality is very good. So whatever be the reason, you are selecting two different plants which are genetically dissimilar and you are crossing them. So that is a scientific procedure, and that procedure is called hybridization. Now, this process of hybridization may be intervarietal, that means between different varieties, or interspecific, that means between different species, or intergeneric, that means between different genus or genera. And another way of improving the crop variety is by introducing a gene. You know what is a gene? Gene is a character that is involved with the hereditary characters, or gene is a functional segment of DNA that is involved in the inheritance or heredity. So this gene is being introduced to a particular plant to obtain a desired characteristic, and these are called genetically modified crops. So all these scientific methods are coming under crop variety improvement. So let me repeat once again. Crop variety improvement involves two important techniques, either hybridization, which means the cross between genetically dissimilar plants for a particular characteristic, or another method is genetically modified crop. That means you are introducing a desired gene to get a proper character into a plant body. So I hope you have understood about the crop variety improvement. Now, why is crop variety improvement done? There are various reasons. There are many reasons. These are the reasons that you can see on the screen. The higher yield. Let me explain that higher yield. Higher yield means the farmer's aim is always to get a bumper crop. You know what is the meaning of bumper crop? To get more and more yield so that every year his production will increase. He will get more and more profit. So the main aim of crop variety improvement is higher yield. That means to increase the productivity in his field or per unit area. Second factor is biotic and abiotic resistance. What are the biotic factors? Biotic factors are insects, diseases, rodents, etc. that may attack the crop. What are the abiotic factors? Drought, salinity, heat, cold, snow, etc. are the abiotic factors. Now, both these factors are equally harmful to the crop. So what does the farmer do? What does he want? He wants to select a variety that will have resistance to both biotic as well as abiotic factors. Means both the biotic as well as abiotic factors should not be able to harm his crops. Third point is change in maturity duration. What is the meaning of that? Suppose a farmer is growing a crop in his field. He is sowing the seeds. After 3 months, he is getting a good harvest. But another farmer is there. He is sowing the seeds, but he is getting the harvest only after 5 months. Now, which seeds are better? Which one is maturing more or faster? Definitely, the first farmer's seeds are better. Why? Because they mature faster. So that he can grow more and more crops in 1 year. So definitely, which seed will the farmer choose? Which variety will he choose? The ones that will have shorter period for maturity. Next one is wider adaptability. What is the meaning of the word adaptability? Adaptation. Adaptation means adjustment to the changes in the environment. The crop should be able to grow even when the temperature changes are there, when the water content is different or higher or lower, or when the salinity level is more or less or less or higher. So all these changes can take place in the surroundings. So if the crop immediately dies at that time, then the farmer will have no use with such crops. So what is his range? What does he want? He wants to grow crops that are having wider adaptability, means the ability to grow in a particular environment, even when there are some changes in the environment. The last point is desirable agronomical characters. What do you mean by agronomic characters? Agronomic means agriculturally economical. So the farmer always wants to grow crops definitely where he gets some benefit. So for that, he grows either the tall crops, which are more branching, or maybe the shorter crops. So which one will he prefer for cereal crops? Cereal crops and all, he needs dwarf crops. Dwarf means short crops, so that harvesting will be easier. And the tall plants or the tall crops or more branching crops will be preferred for fodder crops. Otherwise, the animals will come and eat away his crops. So these are certain characteristics that is called desirable agronomical characters. So these 5 points, children, are very important. So if I ask you the question, what are the few factors on which the crop variety improvement is dependent upon? The factors are higher yield, biotic and abiotic resistance, change in the maturity duration, wider adaptability, and desirable agronomic characters. Now we go to our next topic. So that was all about the crop variety improvement. Now our next topic is crop production management. So variety we have selected. Now what should we do? We should produce the crops. How can we do that? We should know about the nutrients present in the soil. We should know about the irrigation methods, and we should know how to grow the crops. That is very, very important. So first, let us talk about nutrients, nutrient management. You know that we need nutrients for our growth. We need carbohydrates, we need proteins, we need vitamins, we need all of them, and we are getting it from the food. But then plants also, they need it. Where do they get them from? They get it from the air, from the water, and from the soil. There are 16 nutrients required by plants for their proper growth. Air is supplying them 2 important nutrients, that is oxygen and carbon dioxide. Water is also giving them hydrogen and oxygen. And the remaining 13 nutrients are obtained from the soil. 16 they need in all. Out of that, three are being supplied by air and water. That means air is giving them oxygen, carbon dioxide. Water is providing for their hydrogen and oxygen. But the remaining 13 nutrients are obtained from the soil. So among the 16 nutrients, six are required in large quantities, and they are called macronutrients. So those nutrients that are required by the plants in greater quantities, they are called macronutrients. Examples are nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, calcium, magnesium, sulfur. Nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, calcium, magnesium, sulfur. The other seven are required in small amounts or minor amounts, and they are called micronutrients. But soil can also be enriched, you know, made more richer by the addition of certain manures and fertilizers which are providing these nutrients. And what are the examples of micronutrients? Iron, magnesium, boron, zinc, copper, molybdenum, chlorine.